Okay, good morning. So the lectures today are going to cover some aspects of the energy landscape approach to glass forming liquids. So somebody on the way here was sort of saying how great the lectures had been, and I said, just wait, you know. So I'm afraid this lecture, the next two lectures are not going to live up to the standards set by the previous ones, but I got the other lectures to get those wonderful lectures ready, so that's my contribution. So, all right. And of course, whatever isn't particularly clear or illuminating in these two lectures will be made up by David's lectures in the afternoon. So, all right. So to get going, let me see if this works. Okay. Okay. Just to recapitulate some, I'll start by recapitulating some basic things that have already been covered. And also let me, I'm in the second lecture, I'm going to try to finish a little bit earlier so that we have more time for the poster presentation. So those people who are planning to be presenting the one-minute slides, don't be around at around 11:30 or so instead of 12. Okay. So here is a graph that's probably been shown a few times, which is a plot of the log of the viscosity versus inverse temperature. And the observation is that the viscosities in a variety of liquids behave in a much stronger than Arrhenius fashion with temperature and appear to, and are becoming very big. And experimentally, when the viscosity reaches 10 to the 13 poise, which corresponds roughly to relaxation times of tens and hundreds of seconds, one says that the liquid has reached the glass transition temperature. And about this temperature, the system, the supercooled liquid or any other fluid system one is looking at will fall out of equilibrium, and the laboratory glass transition that is described in this way is seen as in a wide range of substances and is a kinetic effect in the sense that one is setting a time scale which is in turn defining this transition temperature. And correspondingly, if one looks at properties of the glasses that are obtained at low temperatures using different protocols. In this, what is attempted to be shown is the volume of a liquid going into the glass state as a function of different cooling rates. So if you cool the liquid fast, it falls out of equilibrium at a higher temperature, reaches a volume that's higher than if it is cooled a little bit slower, and so on. Okay, so the properties of the glass that you obtain depend on the method of preparation. And going back to the data on the viscosities, given the diversity of temperatures, but an apparent similarity of pattern, one can ask if there is a simple-minded scaling of these data that will tell us something simple and non-trivial about how the viscosities of these materials are changing. And so what one attempts is to scale the temperature on the x-axis with the glass transition temperature. And one can ask the question whether such a scaling will lead to data collapse. And the answer that is seen here is no. What one sees instead is a range of behavior from almost Arrhenius to something that departs very strongly from Arrhenius behavior. How rapidly the viscosity changes for a given material in this scale plot is called the fragility of the glass former. And pictorially, one can attempt to get an index of the fragility by looking at the slope of the viscosity in the scaled plot at the glass transition. This is, in fact, what is done in many cases. So a small slope here for something like Germania is indicative of strong behavior, low fragility, whereas a much larger slope for systems on this end indicates that the fragility is large. As you've already heard, the viscosity data is often well described by the Fogel-Fulcher-Thurman form, which I've written in a somewhat unusual way. But basically, there is a divergence temperature T naught at which, by extrapolation, the viscosity will diverge. And the reason I've written it in this fashion is that written this way, this number k here can be seen to be also an index of fragility. And and a second reason to write it in this way is that, as Walter mentioned already, if one looks at the heat capacities of materials, in particular the excess heat capacities of materials, there is a diversity of how the heat capacity behaves. There's a range of behaviors of how much the heat capacity changes at the glass transition, and the magnitude of the jump depends on the fragility, and this can be seen. What is going on? What happened? All right, sorry. I got my slides out of sequence, let me come back to that later on. As I'll show in a little bit, the jump in the heat capacity can be seen to be related to this number here. We'll come to that. But the question that one asks in the context of looking at the behavior of a thermodynamic quantity like the heat capacity is whether this is indicative of a thermodynamic transition. And as already has been discussed, the historical sort of point of this question being raised is the observation of Kaussmann that the excess entropy of glass formers appears by extrapolation to vanish at a finite temperature. And this does not... This paradox is resolved in practice by the intervention of the glass transition before such an eventuality arises. The question that many people are interested in understanding is whether there is a resolution in principle of an entropy vanishing thermodynamic glass transition, and there are indeed proposals that this is so. Walter again discussed one of those proposals. The quantity that is plotted here is the excess entropy, the entropy of the liquid over that of the crystal. And again, as it has been mentioned, since the glass transition, I think Ken mentioned this yesterday, since the glass transition is a liquid state phenomenon, it would be nice to understand the meaning of this purely in terms of the liquid state rather than making reference to the crystal. And so one asks the question, what is the meaning of the excess entropy? And going back to data like this, not very directly, but if you notice in this particular graph, the heat capacity of the crystal and the glass are very similar. And one can deduce or argue from that the entropies of the glass and the crystal are very similar, and therefore one can interpret the procedure of subtracting the crystal entropy as that of subtracting a component of the liquid entropy that is like the entropy of the glass. And in both cases, certainly in the case of the crystal, it's clear that this component of the entropy comes from vibrational motion around a well-defined reference structure. And what we're going to understand from here on about the corresponding quantity in the case of the liquid is that is also the same, that there is a component of the entropy of the liquid that arises from localized vibrational harmonic or otherwise, and that is the quantity that we are subtracting. And therefore, what we are left with is an entropy that is associated with the multiplicity of distinct structures that the liquid can be in. Okay, so I probably don't need to go through this because Walter went through this in good detail, but the connection to dynamics of these considerations is embedded in the form of the Adam-Gibbs relation, which postulates that a liquid can be divided into cooperatively rearranging regions of a size Z, which varies with temperature. And one writes down the probability of rearrangement of these cooperatively rearranging regions in this form, namely that the probability of rearrangement depends exponentially on the size of these regions. And one further argues that by the description that we have given it, this hypothetical cooperatively rearranging region or regions will have essentially the same entropy regardless of how big or small these regions might get. And with that assumption, the total configurational entropy of the liquid can be written as or in terms of the number of such regions one would have, that is the total number of particles divided by the size of each of these regions. And if one plugs this back into the probability of transition between distinct structures that we had in the previous slide, one gets the Adam-Gibbs relation, which relates the relaxation times to the exponential of the inverse of temperature times the configurational entropy. Okay, so again, this expression will result in the VFT equation if the excess heat capacity is assumed to vary as some constant divided by the temperature. And from this expression for the excess heat capacity, one can write an expression for the excess entropy by integrating up from a temperature where we assume that this excess entropy vanishes to whatever temperature one is looking at. And that's the resulting expression. And therefore, temperature times the excess entropy will have the form constant times T over Tk minus 1, which is the form in which I wrote the VFT relation earlier. And therefore, written in this way, one can see that the magnitude of the variation and therefore the jump of the heat capacity at the glass transition can be or is related to the fragility index k that we had in the VFT relation earlier with some multiplicative constants, and we're not going to worry too much about it right now. Okay, so that's a sort of a recap of the necessary context for what I will talk about today, which is the energy landscape approach. And let me start by sort of an intuitive picture of why one thinks this is a useful way of looking at relaxation in glassy systems. Unlike ordered materials like crystals, liquids have a disordered structure, and the potential energy, if one looks at the relevant set of configurations in a liquid, is a complicated function of coordinates of the particles with many local minima. To a first approximation, this is what one means by saying energy landscape. But one has in mind more. But before that, let me say in a different way what the meaning of these local energy minima are. So these are local minima of the potential energy which means that we are talking about mechanically stable configurations of particles, and it has come up earlier in the school that one of the things that one is interested in looking at in the context of understanding the behavior of liquids and glasses is the packing of particles, which is a business started by this man here, J.D. Bernal. And as it has been clear from the seminal work of Bernal, there are, and it's also fairly obvious, if one tries to build mechanically stable packings of particles, there are many different ways of doing so. Okay, so the energy minima that we are talking about, one can sort of have a real space picture as packings of particles which are mechanically stable, and the meaning of packing may differ depending on the interactions that one has. In the case of spherically symmetric atoms or close to spherically symmetric molecules, without directional interactions, a packing is sort of has the meaning of what we normally understand in everyday language. But if you do have directional interactions, the meaning changes a little bit, but the general idea is the same. Okay, now, when one talks about the energy landscape, in addition to just sort of the statement that there are many local minima, one has in mind that this complicated structure of the potential energy surface is actually relevant, okay, to the physics that one is interested in. So as a contrast, if you have a liquid or a low-density fluid, it's also true that the structure is disordered, and the configuration space that is relevant is characterized by many local energy minima. But we don't choose to look at the problem that way because the variations first that one samples is not very relevant to what one might be interested in looking at. For example, if all the states one is interested in have much higher energies than the variation in the potential energy surface, then it's not relevant. Okay, so one, when one says energy landscape, one has in mind that it's actually relevant. Okay, and one of the things that we have to do is to establish that, in fact, the energy surface that is seen by the system in the temperature and density range of interest, is relevant to the dynamics of the system. Okay, so one intuitively expects that this should be the case when one looks at the system at very low temperatures, because when we decrease the temperature, the energies of interaction become more relevant, and at high densities, because this also will have the influence of making the interactions in the problem more relevant. Okay, so again, generically, one should expect that if one were to lower the temperature of the system, the local energy minima that one samples become deeper, and it should get perhaps harder to go from one to the other. And this would have the consequence of increasing the relaxation times. Okay, and as a matter of terminology, these local energy minima, potential energy minima, I'm going to refer to as inherent structures after Stillinger and Weber, who coined the terminology. Okay, so before sort of going on further, let's take, I was going to say, an example where what you see is what you get, but you can't actually see it. But, shoot. Okay, so what is shown, I'm very sorry about this, but if you look hard, let me trace it for you once. There is a potential energy function that goes like this, okay? And so I'm treating a toy example where I have a particle in one dimension which moves subject to an external potential that is sketched here. Okay? And what I have shown here is a space-time plot of the movement of this particle subject to some stochastic, well, this is a Monte Carlo simulation, and I show this particle moving around, moving about at different temperatures, going from a high temperature, which is black, intermediate temperature, that's red, and a low temperature, that's blue. Okay? What you see is that at the highest temperature, the particle is sort of making a fairly random walk across the space. And when you go to the intermediate temperature, what one finds is that there are sort of patches of red here, 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 etc., where the system sort of stays localized for longish periods of time. And if you could see what I can see, you would notice that the place where it's localized is around a minimum of the potential energy that I have down here. And at the lowest temperature, indeed, for very long times, except for brief excursions, this particle gets trapped in one of the local energy minima. Okay, so in this example, clearly, the fact that I have a complicated energy surface is relevant to the dynamics of the particle. And a second point I want you to notice here is that even though the particle is getting trapped at low temperatures around a local energy minimum, it has no difficulty in sampling rapidly the basin of one of these minima. Okay, so that you can sort of judge by how fast it seems to be going back and forth, and that's always a rapid sampling. Yeah. It's not a global minimum, and that's okay. So that's a relevant point. The point is, you know, if I looked at this system for very long, right, I would have a sampling of the different basins. Let's assume that the system is ergodic, right, which means that it'll go all across the energy landscape, and which particular minima it'll sample, or if I now sort of transform the problem not into this real space, but I say, let me look at the problem as a function of energy of the minima, and if I ask the question, which is the basin that it is sampling, right? At high temperatures, it basically doesn't care about the depth of the minima, right? And as I go to lower temperatures, if the system still continues to be ergodic, right, then it'll eventually sort of find an equilibrium probability distribution that'll be biased towards the lower energy minima that one has, right? But on this time scale, the system is actually stuck in the lowest temperature that I've done this simulation. Okay, so the particular minimum that it is stuck in is not significant as a characterization of the equilibrium probability distribution. Who, where?
You were talking about the time scale, which is sort of smaller than the ergodic time scale to explore the basin.
Correct.
But are you also thinking about sweeping temperatures, or you keep the temperature constant?
So in this particular illustration, for each of the trajectories, the temperature is fixed. Okay. Okay. So, so some observations. The first one I already mentioned is that the equilibration in each of the basins of the local energy minima is always rapid. Okay, at intermediate temperatures. Okay, so in the one-dimensional problem, a basin is easy to define, which is so if this is my energy surface, the basin is defined as the subset of the phase space, which is between these. If I'm talking about this particular minimum, the basin of this minimum is this subset of the set of possible configurations. And one way of identifying, which is generally how we do it, is that if I were to start at some arbitrary configuration here, and I subject the system to a local energy minimization, then I map to this particular minimum. Okay, so that's how one talks about local energy minima, and the basin is simply the set of all points that maps to a particular minimum. Okay. Okay, so the other observation is that at intermediate temperatures, there is transient localization of the particle in the basins of different minima at different times. And at the lowest temperature that we looked at, the system gets trapped in a local minimum for very long times. And in order to explore the full phase space, this is the particle has to cross energy barriers. Okay, and more generally, when one is sort of talking about realistic systems, the barriers don't only have to be energetic, but also entropic. And a standard example is if one is looking at a hard sphere of fluid, then there is no energy barrier in the problem, but the system has to find very special trajectories in phase space that lead to a structural rearrangement.
Mm-hmm. Are you now thinking about the system in a lower dimensional space than if you were considering? So I'm thinking if you already consider all the configurational degrees of freedom.
Right.
How do you talk about an entropic barrier?
So what I mean by an entropic barrier is simply that. So let's imagine that, okay, for simplicity, let me take a two-dimensional problem, right? So I have a particle sitting here, and if it's thermalized in the momenta, right, it'll basically have at different times velocities in all different directions. Okay? And let's imagine that there are only these two holes. Actually, I left out when I drew the box, through which the particle can escape this box. Okay? So if you look at the particle for short times, it is actually trapped because, you know, since it's a blind walker, it'll keep doing this, right? So it won't find the door, right? But it's only by either sort of finding that particular initial condition that directly takes it through the door, or through many collisions and exploration of the momentum, the set of momenta that are available to it, that it'll eventually find the door. So this is what one has in mind when one talks about an entropic barrier. Okay, and this is something that is applicable as a notion in this example, as well as in any higher dimensional space. Yeah. Say that again. What do you mean by sensitive? Okay, why don't we come to this? Okay, I mean, see, the point is, depending on the temperature, there is always a most probable range of the values of the energy of the minima. And how we calculate that, I'll go, yeah.
When you talk about entropic barrier, from where? Barrier between what?
Okay. So, so what I'm trying to describe is that if I were to, like I said, if I were to look at an equilibrium probability distribution, this probability distribution, let's say at sufficiently low temperatures, is localized in different parts of the phase space. I mean, if I apply some threshold, right? At long times, the system has to go to all of those pockets, all of those equivalent pockets, okay, in the simplest case. And so the barrier is between one such pocket to another such pocket.
So it's the same as the actual barrier why introduce a separate terminology when it's just the barrier between different bases? It needs to be here and then overcome. It's just
the entropic barrier appears explicitly in every, right? Either single minimum to minimum transitions, or for transitions between groups of local minima, or for multi-barrier steps. The entropic barrier is always explicit within every rate theory derivation that you can produce. So if it's just between two minima, then it's a ratio of, in the harmonic approximation, it's a ratio of vibrational normal mode frequencies. But then if you have a complicated landscape and you want a multi-step pathway, then it becomes an interesting convolution of those different barriers, of those different sets of... Well, actually, it's defined by the ratio of the density of states in a dividing surface divided by the density of states in a minimum. But it's always explicit in every rate theory. So you can separate an entropic part from a potential energy or an enthalpic part.
Not exactly. I mean, basically, the system will go from one region of the phase space to the other if it finds a path, okay? And what we are asking is, what is the probability of finding that path, right? So if one is talking about a simple-minded, one-dimensional energy barrier, that probability is given by a Boltzmann weight for crossing, you know, getting up that high in energy, right? But if you're looking at a multidimensional problem, as David mentioned, also the factors of entropy, meaning how big the door is, will enter, okay? Or how wide the barrier is, which is implicit in sort of rate expressions in the form of a frequency that goes in the denominator. In the orthogonal directions. Okay. Right. Now, of course, as soon as we sort of leave toy examples, one can't really be drawing explicitly the energy surface one is talking about, so one must go on to a statistical description of the problem. And so here... let's start by doing that for this invisible potential energy surface. Without even seeing what that function looks like, if one asks what is a good statistical description of the energy surface that one is talking about, since we are focusing attention at the moment on energy minima, one obvious quantity is to just make a histogram of the number of minima that I have as a function of the energy of the bins into which I categorize them. Okay, so that is given here. So I define this quantity n of phi as the number of minima in an interval phi and phi plus delta phi. And once I have defined this distribution, I can, in following standard practice, define an entropy density, right? Since I'm talking about a multiplicity of states, at the log of that multiplicity of states gives me an entropy, which I'm going to call the configurational entropy. Okay, and this is an entropy density, which is a function of the energy that I'm talking about. But if I now say that at any given temperature, I have some most probable value of the energy that I sample of the minima, then I can talk about a temperature-dependent configurational entropy that I can calculate in a straightforward way. Okay. Right. So with that introduction, let me now go on to talking about the potential energy landscape picture in the context of supercooled liquids. And this set of ideas goes back to Martin Goldstein back 40 years ago. And he, based on various considerations, argued that at low temperatures, when the relaxation times become of the order of nanoseconds, the relaxation or flow, as he calls it, is dominated by potential energy barriers, potential barriers high compared to thermal energies, which have to be crossed in order for the system to relax. Okay, and subsequently, this was sort of revisited by Stillinger and Weber, who also undertook a series of computer simulation studies where they also coined this term, inherent structures, and attempted to formulate the thermodynamics of a liquid in terms of these local energy minima and their basins, the properties of the basins surrounding them. Okay, so again, since one talks about different energy landscapes, just to sort of be clear, what we are talking about now is just, in simple words, the potential energy of a three n or an n particle system, which is a surface in 3n plus 1 dimensional space as a function of 3n coordinates. Okay, and here it is in two dimensions. So I just have a cartoon of a potential energy surface in two dimensions, and each of these minima is called an inherent structure, and the black lines that are shown here separate the basins of each of these minima. Okay. Well, plus one is because if you have a function, so 3n is the number of independent variables, and then you're plotting a function of this 3n variable, so that's the plus one, okay? It could be plus or minus a few depending on, conserved quantities and so on, but yeah, that this is assuming that all configurations are available. Okay. Okay, so anyway, the point is this energy surface or landscape is a function which is independent of anything. It's dependent on the Hamiltonian of the problem. But what is dependent on the temperature, and that's what we're going to be talking about, is the part of this surface that is sampled. Okay, this will depend on the temperature. So not the surface, but what we sample in this surface. Okay. So as I alluded to in referring to Stillinger and Weber, a lot of the work in studying the potential energy landscape has been done through computer simulations. So this is sort of a mixed bag, because it's one of the, if you want to sort of look at the sort of positive side of it, it's one of the types of analysis where computer simulations play an essential role as experiments. Okay, so you're looking at quantities in principle which you don't have direct experimental access to, but you believe are important for understanding what you're trying to understand, namely the relaxation of a liquid. And therefore, computer simulations are very handy. It's also a negative because ultimately one would like to have a direct access to the quantities one invokes in an analysis, but that's unfortunately not the case here. Okay? So on the other hand, one can sort of use the energy landscape quantities as an intermediate and try to relate quantities that are directly experimentally measurable. Okay. I'm not going to repeat this for the rest of the talk, so just to sort of summarize what one does typically, one is looking at molecular dynamic simulations to generate a trajectory in configuration space of a collection of interacting particles under typically constant energy or temperature conditions, and this is sort of standard stuff. In looking at the energy landscape, what one does typically is to take one of these trajectories, that is a cartoon of which is shown in two dimensions here, and take samples along the way. These black dots are samples of the configurations that I take out from the trajectory. So I have a discrete time series, and I subject them to a local energy minimization so that this configuration map to that minimum, that instantaneous configurations map to that minimum. Okay, so so by doing so, one generates a statistics. This is sort of if one is doing energy minimization, one can do other things. But by doing this, one is generating a statistics of the local energy minima that are sampled, and one can then calculate the properties of these. Of course, in a normal molecular dynamics study, one is also looking at the dynamics of the liquid, which is probed through the diffusion of particles, density correlation functions, etc. So the object will be to correlate these two types of quantities one calculates.
Excuse me, you mentioned that you're working on the time scales smaller than the time scale. Therefore, you're saying you cannot use statistical mechanics to generate the statistics, right?
No. I said in the toy example, at the lowest temperature, I was working with time scales that are lower than the ergodic time scales,
but not now, not anymore.
So now, So we'll see. I mean, there will be. If you want anybody to believe a computer simulation that you've done of a supercooled liquid, you have to demonstrate that you've done an equilibrium sampling, unless. That's not your goal. I mean, sorry, not that's. I don't mean to convince other people, but you could. So there are special cases where you are looking at out of equilibrium behavior. Okay, but if unless explicitly stated, you assume that the liquid you're looking at is sampling its configuration space ergodically. Okay, So here, as I said, one of the things that we have to demonstrate is that the sampling of the energy landscape is actually relevant for the physics we're interested in. And here I go through a study of the Cobb-Anderson binary Leonard-Jones mixture, which is a widely studied model system for, I keep coming in your way, I think. So what is done here is to simulate the liquid, and here is actually a case where one doesn't a priori ensure that the liquid is in equilibrium, okay? So what one is doing is to take the liquid starting at some high temperature and to cool it at a constant rate, okay? Like one might do in a typical glass formation study, right? You take the liquid where it's ergodic, and then you cool it at a constant rate. And then you look at what happens, okay? The particular quantity we're looking at here is the energy of the inherent structures that one samples in the manner that I described, the average energy, as a function of temperature, okay? So one does this at different cooling rates, and one has these three following observations. One is that at high temperatures, the energy of the inherent structures, the average energy, is nearly constant. Okay? It doesn't vary very much with temperature. Okay? The second observation is that below some temperature, the energy of the inherent structures begins to go to lower and lower values. And the third observation is that at sufficiently low temperatures, it gets stuck at different values that depend on the cooling rate. Okay? This last observation pertains to the fact that the system is actually falling out of equilibrium, and it is falling out of equilibrium at temperatures and energies of the local minima that depend systematically on the cooling rate. Okay? And more concretely, if one were to sort of take pains to do that analysis, the temperature at which the system falls out of equilibrium, just like in the discussion of the glass transition experimentally, corresponds to a relaxation time that is proportional to the cooling rate. Okay? So this is, in fact, if you will, one way of determining the glass transition, the computer simulation equivalent of the glass transition for this liquid. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just curious, why does it get stuck so flat in energy? In other words, if you did it, this isn't a density, but if you did a volume plot, there's a slope to that. And I've seen this in density pictures of certain simulations too, where it gets really much flatter than what's observed experimentally. And I'm just wondering why that is.
Okay, the reason is, okay, so let me first address the volume part of it, right? Which is, when you're looking at the local energy minima, right, you are actually removing from consideration any expansion or contraction that has to do with just vibrational motion, anharmonic vibrational motion. Okay, so it will be, so if I were to plot in an appropriate simulation the volume of the local energy minima, it will be flatter because it doesn't have any even vibrational expansion, okay, which is there in the real system, and the same applies to this. Okay, so the temperature below which the deeper minima are sampled is, I'm going to call it the onset temperature, and if one then goes and looks at the dynamics of the system, so here I've just reproduced one of those curves that I showed in the previous graph, and again, invisible, does anybody know what to do with this? Is there some color? Yeah. Okay, well, if it happens too often, we'll try and do that. Yeah, just try once. Shall I keep talking? Can you do it? Okay. maybe not. Energy, okay, and if I do that, what I see for this particular system is that at high temperatures, the so-called activation energy is a number; it's a constant, and that's sort of what I expect if I have Arrhenius behavior. But what I also find is that below the temperature at which I begin to see this drop in the inherent structure energies, this effective activation energy is becoming bigger and bigger. Okay, this means that when the system begins to sample deeper energy minima, my effective activation energy is becoming larger. Okay, so what this tells us is that below this onset temperature, the energy landscape, it's actually meaningful to talk of an energy landscape. okay, that the sampling of the minima on my potential energy surface seems to correlate with changes that I see in the dynamics. Okay, so I'm not showing what happens down there. Basically, when it gets stuck, your relaxation time you cannot measure because you're not doing a long enough simulation at those temperatures for the system to be in equilibrium, which is a precondition for you to measure a correlation relaxation time.
So, is there a priori some relationship that we should expect between the depth of the energy minima and the height of the barrier? I mean, is it obvious? It's not immediately obvious to me why those two have to be correlated like that.
Well, if you expect that there is some threshold energy to which you have to rise to before you can sort of go on to exploring other parts of the free energy surface, then there would be an obvious correlation. And that's indeed, that seems to be the case, though I'm not going to talk about that. There is. Right.
You can do whatever. Well, it seems it's somehow the physics of the Hamiltonians that if you are changing something, that you also correlate with the height
right.
of the
mass. Right. So, correct. Yeah. No, so basically, just to paraphrase what Walter is saying, I could take an energy surface that corresponds to some Hamiltonian, and I can construct another energy surface with bigger barriers, right? Between so this you can do, and in fact people have done that, including some of the luminaries that I've mentioned. But I think it's a little bit. It's a cautionary note that one should keep in mind, but one shouldn't sort of get carried away with that kind of logic, right? And I think for having a realistic idea of what structure one should look at the detailed connectivity of the configuration space, which David is going to tell you a lot all about. Okay.
No, I had just also points. I think because it is always confusing when we are looking at those quantities, is that the energy of the depth is proportional to the size of your system, and the barrier is always proportional to a small number of particles. So it shouldn't be confused about something which is
okay.
size of the volume and something which is of order one. I think this
okay.
is.
This is. I understand what you're saying, but one should also keep in mind, I mean, there's a double negative here, which is that if one is actually going to be thinking about relaxation in some region of the space, the extensivity of the energy, the total energy of the minima is not relevant, okay? So I guess the mental construction that you have to make is that you're looking at a system that's just the right size, that your correlation lengths are not larger than your system size, but it's not too big compared to your correlation lengths. Okay, these are sort of for the experts. Right, did I go back? Yes? No? I guess I just, this is a, okay, repetition. Okay. Okay, so now that's regarding the time dependence of the relaxation times. The way I got to that was by looking at quantities that are shown here, so in this particular case, it's a self part of the Van Hover correlation function, which has been introduced to you, and I'm looking at it at different temperatures, and as I go to low temperatures, as Walter already, or did you also, one of the previous lecturers described, one is developing a plateau, looking at the time on the log scale. And in any case, for us, what is important is that the relaxation times are getting bigger and bigger. What is also seen is that the form of this long time relaxation changes from an exponential to a stretched exponential form. And so what I show here for a different system, not the Cobb-Anderson mixture where also this is seen, is in, well, on this side of the axis, is the stretch exponent in the KWW fit to the long time relaxation of these quantities. And what you find is that as the inherent structure energies decrease, begin to drop, which is shown on the left-hand side of the graph, so also does the KWW functional form. So what that means is that not only is, so if I tried to construct a picture, so the simplest picture I could make is that I have sort of some lid to which I have to get to. So if I am sampling deeper minima, I have a larger energy barrier, but that will not be sufficient to explain the fact that the dynamics is also getting more complicated. Okay, so there are two things that are happening. One is that the effective energy barriers are getting bigger, but the nature of the dynamics is becoming more complex, as quantified by, yeah.
I guess that there's a question here, because a huge amount of experimental data says that time-temperature superposition is a reasonable approximation. I'm not saying it's an exact approximation. So this, if you actually have a KWW function as opposed to just a fit over some time window that is changing, this suggests that you have very strong deviations from time-temperature superposition.
Right.
Okay, well, so that first question is why?
Okay.
Is that then a problem with this particular simulation model compared to reality, I guess?
Okay, but the second question is?
Well, then the other possibility is that, in fact, you don't have a KWW function and you really do have time-temperature superposition, but the segment of time over which you can fit that function is not big enough to actually find what the real function is.
Okay, so...
And we've seen that. I mean, we have samples where we take in and you can do individual KWW fits to the data you take, but when you change temperature, it looks like the KWW function factor is a function of temperature. But in fact, if you take the curves and shift them manually, you get time temperature superposition. So the master curve is not KWW.
Okay. So my answer to this, and I think there are people who will disagree. So let me ask you a counter question, which is, if I take a glass former where I have sufficient range in experiments in temperature, if I go to sort of near boiling point temperatures, do you expect stretched exponential relaxation?
No.
But hypothetically, if it's a fragile glass former near the glass transition, do you expect KWW? Yes.
Or I would say some non-exponential decay.
No, some non-exponential decay. So my understanding of this apparent contradiction is that both experimentally and also in some of the theoretical discussion, one has in mind a relatively narrow range of temperatures near the glass transition, where the relaxation times are actually changing a lot, right? So one makes sort of a comparative statement that while the relaxation times are changing by orders of magnitude, there is no change in the KWW. So I would be happy with if somebody said for six decades above the glass transition temperature, you have time temperature superposition.
So
could
you see that
here? I mean, well, Walter probably has something to say. Yeah.
I want to attack you, but basically in the same direction. Because if you take the case of silica, again, because it is what it is, there I would expect that the energy landscape also goes down. But the simulation showed that the beta is first high, goes down, and then comes up again because the transport properties are changing.
Yeah.
So this correlation, I mean, granted, what I leave to you or I believe is that something is happening at this onset temperature. The rest, I don't buy it.
The rest meaning what?
Well, that they are tracking each other.
No, this.
So you don't buy it either?
No. So exactly like this, no. Right?
Okay.
I show it because
okay,
it's
so that's
easy
what
to
I wanted
see
to see.
Yeah. Okay. But no, but in the case of silica, what is happening is presumably.
And at a lower temperature than this, at a lower frequency. So the when the temperature domain and the frequency domain that when this crossover shows up is higher temperature, way above glass transition temperature, at high, very high frequency, which can be found by neutron diffraction. Well, neutron in scatter scattering, and that's the intermediate function that he showed. So neutron scattering would show this crossover, not the regular measurement.
Oh, well, no. So that may well happen, and but we're not looking at sufficiently low temperatures here to see that. I can't answer it offhand, but if you're talking about the experimental TG, it's way below. So we're nowhere near, right? Yeah, for this system, I don't know if it has actually been estimated in terms of whatever method, right? So, okay, I don't have, in the Cobb-Anderson system, there have been estimates of TK, so one could, in principle, get a TG value. So there it's, just to give you numbers, I mean, the simulation range is down to reduced temperatures of about 0.45, and TK is 0.3. But I don't think the temperature range is really quantitatively relevant. I think it's what's happening to the dynamics, what's happening to the thermodynamics of the system, and saying that you're within 40% of TG doesn't have much meaning. No? So, okay. Okay, so anyway, so that was sort of, that was just to, so all of that discussion was to say that the emergence of interesting dynamics in the liquid is associated with a non-trivial sampling of the potential energy surface. And so the next item that I'll go through quickly before we stop is something called the Goldstein crossover, which I made reference to earlier. So Goldstein argued that there is a crossover to activated dynamics when relaxation times reach the range of nanoseconds. And subsequent sort of discussion has associated the Goldstein crossover with the mode coupling temperature, which you will hear about tomorrow. Yeah, tomorrow, day after tomorrow. So the idea, the physical picture one has of what happens in this temperature range is that there is a good separation of vibrational and activated dynamics, okay? And as sort of sketched here. So one can sort of probe this by asking, if I were to look at the dynamics of the system, not by analyzing the trajectory of instantaneous configurations, but at each point in time, let's say, I map my system to the local energy minima, right? And I'll consider the time series of local energy minima. How will my relaxation functions, etc., look? And if indeed there is a very clear separation between vibrational and relaxational motions in the system, one should see that the time correlation functions. Let me just go to it. So what one is doing is one takes an MD trajectory, like shown here schematically. This is the work of Thomas Schroeder and others. And one maps at each instant the system to the local energy minimum, and one then has a time series of local energy minima, and one looks at time correlation functions in the same way one does for the instantaneous configurations. And what one finds is shown here. This is the self part again of the Van Hove correlation function for the MD trajectory, right? What one finds is that the usual development of a plateau, and the amplitude of the plateau is roughly constant, which is expected. And whereas if one looks at the inherent structure dynamics, what one finds is that as one goes to low temperatures, the long-time relaxation behavior extends to lower and lower times, and the amplitude of the plateau is increasing to 1. Okay, this is shown quantitatively here. This is the non-ergodicity parameter as a function of temperature for the instantaneous, for the MD trajectory, and this is the non-ergodicity factor for the inherent structure dynamics. And what is also shown here for reference to sort of ensure that one is doing something sensible as far as looking at the long-time dynamics of the system is a comparison of the relaxation times. So there are two sets of symbols here. As usual, one of them you can't see. And here also there are two sets of symbols which basically fall on top of each other. And this is the relaxation times from the MD trajectory versus the relaxation times from the inherent structure dynamics, and similarly the stretch exponent. And what you see is that, in fact, the long-time dynamics as described by the sequence, the time series of local minima, is the same. But what is different is what is happening to the plateau in the dynamics, which disappears. So this is a measure of the statement that there is a clear separation between vibrational and basin hopping dynamics. This is made a little bit,
Please go back to
one more.
Could you please comment on the logarithmic
decay? Yeah, no, it's something that is very interesting and should be looked at, but I don't have. I mean, this looks like aging dynamics, but I don't have more to say. But it's someday somebody should look at it. Okay. Yeah. This one? Well, no. So if I'm looking at the dynamics of hops between local energy minima, there is no vibrational relaxation, right? So there's only relaxation through hopping between minima. And what this is indicating is that as you go to this mode coupling temperature, there are no different regimes in time to this dynamics, right? So, yes, no, maybe. What? Right. Yeah. So, so each of the transitions is contributing to the long time decay. Okay. But you know, but I it's not a very rigorous statement, but what I'm showing next is to sort of flesh that out a little bit more, which is looking at the saddle points, which is something that I haven't talked about, but just briefly, and I think just as I can map my instantaneous configurations to local energy minima, I can also ask the question, with some ambiguity actually, whether what is the closest saddle point to the instantaneous configuration that I'm starting with, and I can ask what what is the index of that saddle point, how many downhill directions I have. Since I have a 3n-dimensional configuration space, I can have a saddle point, which is called a transition state, which is a single direction, which is downhill. But I could have also multiple directions that are downhill, and the rest uphill at the saddle point. Okay, so the saddle point is defined as a point where the force, the gradient of the potential, is zero. But this can happen either because you're sitting at a minimum or you're sitting at a critical point of this kind. According to Goldstein's conjecture, what should happen if I go to sufficiently low temperature is that the system is close to local energy minima most of the time, and I therefore have crossing of barriers. Okay, and if that is true, what should happen is that the index of the saddle points that I look at as a function of temperature should approach zero as I approach the temperature where I expect this crossover to a barrier hopping picture. Okay, and that is indeed what one sees. So this is for comparison, but not something to worry about too much. I can look at the number of negative eigenvalues of my curvature matrix at a given point in space, and this decreases but doesn't go anywhere near zero. What is shown on the y-axis here is the number of negative eigenvalues divided by the total number of eigenvalues. Okay. On the other hand, if one looks at the saddle points that I map my instantaneous configuration to, one does indeed see that this index fraction is approaching zero at some finite temperature. And correspondingly, if one looks at the energy, these guys made a comparison between the instantaneous energy of the system, the inherent structure energy of the system, which shows this behavior that I've already described of being relatively flat at high temperatures and then dropping down, and the energy of the nearest saddle points. What one sees is that the energy of the closest saddle points on average is approaching that of the local energy minima, okay, which is an indication that there is a change in the character of the dynamics that is emerging as one goes to this crossover temperature. Okay, so changes in the nature of the dynamics captured by the properties of the sampled energy surface is the take-home message of that segment. We'll stop. Questions?
Sorry, just a quick question. I did not understand exactly what was the difference between plot A and B in the previous slide.
A and B?
Yeah.
This is the instantaneous configuration.
So you can find the eigen values also for the instantaneous configuration. Then you quench the...
Right. Okay. Now, the point is, some of the qualitative pictures you have will work quantitatively if you have well-behaved energy landscapes. But in any realistic system, there are lots of anharmonicities which may not be significant for the kind of qualitative description that we want to have. So you will have, even if you, for example, had only an energy minimum, you could have anharmonicities that lead to negative eigenvalues, right? Without barrier crossing. So what is attempted to be done here is to sort of clean up by mapping the system to the closest saddle point. Any other questions? Yeah? Here? May well happen. I think not for this system, but for silica. Silica seems to be so you know, this it doesn't quite go to zero. Even when you go below, there are sort of a small number of negative curvature directions, but certainly there is a tilting of the balance in terms of, you know, if you look at typical configurations, there is a change in behavior, but the number doesn't vanish in that case. But here I'm not sure if that analysis has been done. Yes. Right. Well, no. So this implies that. Sorry, I didn't quite understand the question. But the nearest. Right. Or that the saddle point in question is a minimum, or the critical point in question is a minimum, right? So the index of the saddle points is decreasing as you go to low temperatures. Yeah.
At high temperature, the closest critical point is a saddle with a given index.
Correct.
And when you go to this crossover temperature, this is 0.5, I don't remember, the closest point is the minimum.
Right.
But then the barrier can be much higher. I mean, in general, it's much higher than at higher temperature.
Correct.
Okay.
I see. Yeah. Right. So I think, okay, so I don't have the slides here, but there has been some calculation of the energy difference going from one saddle of a given index to the next one, and they're roughly so. Yeah. So even if you are if I look below this temperature, the system is mapping to a local energy minimum, but I don't offhand know information about where the barrier is, okay? But what I can expect is that with the information I have, that the barrier will be of the order of the distance to the next the saddle point of the next index, okay? And so the estimate here for the barrier between minima at TC is something like 10 times the temp, you know, it's 10 kbt. That is not shown here in these slides, but that estimate has been made. Yeah.
So if you calculate the probability distributions for saddles with increasing index,
right,
so basically shift of gases,
right,
constant shifts between the intensive properties because they're local barriers.
Right.
So, you know, roughly of order epsilon.
Right.
But with a tail, which is ill-defined because it contains various stuff in it that isn't related to,
right,
you know, cage-breaking processes.
Right.
So it converges to a finite number. But.
All right. So let's take a break and be back here at 10:45. Y-axis were plotting. So let me just make a simple cartoon. So if I have, let's say, a system with two coordinates, a minimum is one where it's a minimum in all the directions. So this would, in that notation, correspond to an index of zero. And if it's a saddle point, I have one minimum direction and one maximum direction, and this would correspond to an index of one. And if I had, this would correspond to n equal to 2, et cetera. Okay. And the data normalized by the total number of directions there are. Okay. Are there any other questions about this before I go on? Okay. Right. Okay. So, you know, I think I have too many slides. So I'll try to be selective. So I'm going to skip over a lot of them, and if you have any questions, I'll describe what is whizzing by, and if you want to stop me, you can stop me. Okay, but so here, what I want to describe is having sort of given some reason why we should be looking at the energy landscape and its properties as sampled at any given temperature. I would like to go through the formulation of the thermodynamics of the system in terms of the local energy minima and their statistics. And so if I have the partition function of a system, which is proportional with, you know, I'm not going to worry about prefactors, an integral over the configuration space of the exponential of minus beta v, where v is the total interaction potential, I can rewrite this total partition function as a sum over any set of non-overlapping subvolumes which cover the space, right? So this is quite general. No justification needed. But in this particular context, what I have in mind is that I'm going to subdivide it such that each of the indices alpha here corresponds to the basin of one local minimum. Okay, so I'm summing over all the local minima. And again, the total interaction energy, I think there's a typo here, sorry about that. The beta is outside. Well, there should be one more bracket there. The interaction energy I can write as the energy at the minimum plus whatever is above the minimum, right? So written this way, I can pull out the Boltzmann factor corresponding to the energy of the minimum out of the integral, and the integral here is over the volume of a given basin. And now, if I look at this quantity here, I'm basically looking at one basin where the energies are expressed above the minimum value. And if I had nice harmonic basins, I could sort of calculate this quantity easily. And subsequently, we're going to make the assumption that we do have nice harmonic basins. But we will go one step further and sort of demonstrate that, in fact, in some cases, at least, it's valid, okay? But it's not a fundamental assumption. It's just a matter of convenience. But the basic point is this integral here over one basin is sort of what the partition function would look like if I was doing a calculation for a crystal, right? I would express my energies, of course, with respect to the ideal crystal energy, and then I assume that I have phonons, and I do a partition function integral by calculating first the phonon spectrum, and then I know what to do, okay? Either quantum mechanically or classically, and so that's sort of what we are going to do here, okay? But because we have a summation here over an exponential number of different local energy minima, in order to proceed further, we're going to make an assumption, which again can be and has been sort of tested numerically at least, which is that the quantity here, which I defined to be my basin free energy because of the analogy that I mentioned, will not depend on, I guess the right way to say it is I will not make much of a mistake if I assume that it depends on the energy of the minimum, but not on other details, Okay. Therefore, I can index instead of a discrete index for each local minimum, I can think of indexing this basin free energy term in terms of the energy of the minimum. Okay. If I do that, this summation here with the replacement of this integral by this expression, exponential minus beta basin free energy, I can write this now as a sum over all the energies of the local energy minima. But of course, when I do that, I'm going to club together all the minima which have the same energy which have the same energy. So I have a degeneracy factor here, right? So, well, this is I kept the summation just to for continuity, but this is now an integral. I'm integrating over all the range of possible energies of the inherent structures. There's a degeneracy factor, which is the density of the of the minima at a given energy, okay? And then I had this factor here, which have exponential minus beta phi, which came from here, and then this term has gone here. And as I said, I've thrown away this index alpha, and I'm assuming that the basin free energy is a function of the energy of the inherent structures. Okay, so, and of course, once I in the standard way, I rewrite this to convert this degeneracy factor to an entropy density in the exponent. Okay, so by doing this, I have now written the total partition function of the system in terms of basin free energies and configuration entropy density. I mean, if I didn't have the basin free energy, this is sort of the general expression that one writes when one is writing partition functions as a sum over the energy of the states that one has in a system. Okay, so this assumption for the sake of simplicity right now, but you'll see that this is actually a fairly good description model glass formers that one has studied. One can sort of make the assumption that one has a density of states that is Gaussian. Okay. Now, this is a reasonable assumption if one is not looking at the tails of the distribution. So unless, you know, because if I can, if I can think of my system at any, I can think of my system as being composed of sort of subunits, each of which will have some distribution of possible energies, and near the peak of the distribution through some application of the central limit theorem, I expect a Gaussian distribution. But this will not be valid unless there are more stringent conditions as I go towards the tails of the distribution. Okay? In what I'm going to discuss subsequently, I'm going to sort of go through and apply this approximation all the way through, but with this caveat that I've mentioned right now. Okay. We will also consider one exceptional case. Okay, so now if I write the density of states as a Gaussian, my configuration entropy density has this form where this alpha here tells you the total number of states, because the density of states corresponding to this will be exponential alpha n times a Gaussian function. And so that alpha is just the total number of states. And phi naught is the most probable energy for the inherent structures. And sigma is the variance. Okay. Now, So this is now one approximation. And the other approximation I already mentioned is that I can think of approximating my basins as being harmonic. Okay. So not too low temperatures, I assume that it's a Gaussian, and for not too high temperatures, I assume the basins to be harmonic. And in a previous lecture describing this, somebody asked me, so at what temperatures is it valid? And I said, obviously at intermediate temperatures, which is roughly the correct answer, because you will see exactly what that intermediate temperatures means. But so there is some range of temperatures where we hope this will be valid. Okay. So if I have a harmonic basin, if I have a method to calculate the vibrational frequencies, I can write down the partition function and the basin free energy. Okay? So this is just given in terms of the frequencies nu I, where the index now is over all eigenvalues. Okay? And now that's sort of a general description, and even at this level, it's not exactly, I mean, I don't have a concrete expression to work with, so I'm going to make a further approximation. And this is an approximation that's motivated by what you see in systems where you calculate this. And so, as I said, what I can think of doing is, let's suppose I have some set of frequencies at some reference temperature, right? So I can write the reference temperature, can be infinity, or a reference inherent structure energy, which is the max. So I'm choosing it to be the maximum of the distribution. And I say that I'm going to write my basin free energy always as the basin free energy for the reference configurations, but at whatever temperature I'm looking at, plus a correction which arises from the fact that the basin free the frequencies at the minima are changing as I go from inherent structures at one energy to inherent structures at another energy. Okay? And what I'm going to assume now is that this change is linear in the energy of the minima. Okay? And this is neither necessary nor generally valid, but it's observed in some cases, and it has been used as a fairly realistic representation in some pieces of work. No, it's the maximum of the distribution, so it's the highest minimum, right? That you will sample physically. Okay. So if I do that basically these are all sort of ways in which you simplify the problem so you can write down the answer, because now you have a Gaussian density of states, and you have a basin free energy that's linear in energy, and you can integrate the partition function, you can integrate to get the full partition function, which is a Gaussian integral. And you can then look at different quantities. You can look at the average energy of the minima, and you find that the average energy of the minima that you sample at a given temperature, apart from a constant term, goes as the inverse of the temperature. Okay, and this is in fact the result that was written down first by Derrida for the random energy model. This is basically working out to be the same thing, and I can also write down an expression for the configurational entropy, and just to sort of make that obvious. If I know what the energy as a function of temperature is, if I plug that in, then I get the configuration entropy as a function of temperature. Okay? And now you will notice, therefore, if this is going as 1 over T, I have 1 over T minus something squared, okay, which is I can factorize it into a 1 plus T and a 1 minus T term. And 1 plus 1 over T and a 1 minus 1 over T term, because the point is what we needed to have the configurational entropy in order to get VFT was that I had a T over TK minus 1 term and a constant in front. Okay, we don't quite get that if we do all this. Of course, we're making approximations about the form of the density of states. So this is what you get with those approximations. But what you do get is an expression for this coefficient. And that is what we're really interested in. And the form of the coefficient tells you that, so if this was a constant, right, from what I told you earlier, this should give me an expression for the fragility, right? It's not quite a constant, but if you look at the form of it, which is messy, but I'll simplify it in a minute for you, there is a 1 plus tk over t term, and if I'm sufficiently above tk, this is roughly constant, so it's going to look like a constant, right? But if I look at sort of numbers that describe my energy landscape and ask which of those numbers is relevant for determining the fragility, first, let me eliminate this delta S here, okay? The delta S was the slope for how much my vibrational entropy varied with the energy of the minima. And this actually, you know, at least in a simple-minded case, is not very significant, so I can say, assume that it's constant, right? So, so this delta S will then become zero. So if I get rid of delta S, basically I'm left with this combination here, which is sigma square root of alpha. And if you ask what is that combination, it's basically the span of your density of states over which you have finite configurational entropy. It's how broad, yeah?
So the SC is basically the density of states, right, of the minima. And so is the last but one equation, that's an independent assumption. No, last but one, from the bottom, SC is proportional to T minus TK minus 1. That's an independent assumption, or is it derived from the...
See, basically I had... this partition function to calculate.
Yeah.
I made an assumption that this is Gaussian.
Okay.
And I made a further assumption that this is linear in phi. So I can do that integration. So that's the answer you get if you make those assumptions.
Okay. So that's derived from those two assumptions.
Right.
Okay,
yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. So basically what you get out of this is a sort of a satisfactory answer to what determines the fragility of a system, and the answer is that if your distribution of inherent structure energies is broader, your fragility will be higher. Or conversely, if you have a very narrow distribution of inherent structure energies, then you'll have a strong glass former. Okay? So, okay. And... okay, so it came from a combination of, so here in the beginning of the lecture, I told you that if my temperature times delta S had this form, right, this constant here determined the fragility, because I could plug this into the VFT functional form, et cetera, yeah? So what I show here is, okay, so that I've sort of roughly got something which looks like that, and I'm trying to understand, you know, if I simplify it sufficiently, what do I get out as the answer for what determines the fragility? And the answer is that it's the breadth of the distribution of minima that determines the fragility. Okay. Sorry. That's okay. Here, it's no longer delta S, because what I said earlier was that the delta S in that we normally calculate is a surrogate for the configurational entropy that is associated with the degeneracy of local minima, which is what I'm calculating now. Yeah. You will see. There is a the case of silica that I will show. Where is Peter? There he is, in case you have complicated questions. But that will show that particular case, right? Okay, so I before I go on, let me just sort of quickly say that based on the sort of the expressions that I've written down, there were sort of these few numbers that determined the landscape as far as the thermodynamics was concerned, namely the total number of states and the breadth of the distribution and the energy of the most probable inherent structures. So now what I had in mind, even though I didn't state it explicitly, was that I was looking at a canonical ensemble, right? So I was sitting at one particular volume, yeah? But so I can ask, you know, what is going to happen if I change the volume of the system, right? And so one way of describing the change in the volume of the system is to say that the parameters that describe the energy landscape are going to change. And so those numbers, if I am going to be looking at something other than a canonical ensemble, or if I needed to bring into consideration the dependence on the volume of the system, I will treat those numbers as functions of the volume of the system, of the density of the system, right? So if I do that, then, so in this part, in this partition function, so this alpha is a function of volume, this phi naught is a function of volume, sigma is a function of volume, and so forth. And now if I write down the free energy, that will be implicitly a function of volume, right? And the free energy had the simple form. I had the energy, the most probable energy of the minimum, the configurational entropy that corresponded to it, and the vibrational free energy that corresponded to it. And now if I were to look at the change in the free energy when I change the volume, the obvious quantity to look at is the pressure, because that is the derivative of the Helmholtz free energy if I change the volume of the system, or if I differentiate with respect to the volume. But the nice thing is this way of writing the free energy gives me a handle on sort of trying to understand what contributions to the pressure come from where. Okay, because there are terms that depend on, so this is clearly a vibrational free energy. So the derivative of this term, I'll say, is the vibrational component of the pressure. And the rest of it is the inherent, I'm going to call it, or Francesco Shortino and colleagues call it, the inherent structure contribution of the pressure. Okay? We'll come back to this again at the end of the talk, but I just mention it here because it's sort of an extension of whatever I said earlier. So now we go back to various things that I've said. One is the assumption of the harmonicity of the basins. Now, before I proceed, let me say that, you know, this assumption is not really necessary to do everything that we're doing, except some things will become more complicated, right? And similarly, the significance of what I'm going to say regarding the harmonicity or otherwise should be taken with a little bit of caution, because, the results I'm going to show you are for a Leonard-Jones mixture that I mentioned earlier, the Cobb-Anderson-Leonard-Jones mixture. But for the case of water, right, the basins are never quite, they're never harmonic. So you have to do something different. And the analysis that I'm going to present in that case will have to be done differently. Okay? So with that caveat, let me proceed. So based on the partition function that I wrote, the probability of finding at a given temperature inherent structures of a given energy are given by the Boltzmann weight that was inside the partition function integral, the energy of the minima, the basin free energy, and the configurational entropy density. normalized by the total partition function. Okay. Now, if I had a way, and in computer simulations one does, of finding this distribution function. So all I have to do in a simulation is to run a simulation, generate the samples of instantaneous configurations that I minimize, and I build a histogram of energies. Okay. And if I had a way of calculating the total partition function, which is to say the total free energy of the system, which I do because there are various methods, but the particular one that I mean, you guys use that to, but I guess you didn't use the normalization. You didn't use it for normalization, but you did the thermodynamic integration to calculate the total free energy. So this is available. And so then if I, now I'm left, so if I know these two things reliably, I'm left with the validity of my assumption about the basin free energy. And if I make valid assumptions about this, I should get good estimates of the configuration entropy by inverting this relationship. Okay? So this is one way of checking whether if I made an assumption about the harmonicity of the basins, if that assumption is valid. Because I can do all this calculation for different temperatures, and if I'm doing things consistently, I'm going to get an estimate of the configuration entropy density that's going to agree with each other. Okay, so we do that, and what you find, this is actually, okay, results for different densities of the system. It doesn't matter, it's just independent, different data sets as far as you're concerned. What you find is that when you do this analysis for a range of low temperatures, your results agree very well with each other. So there's sort of a bunch of symbols here which you can't resolve very well because they all sit on top of each other. But as you keep going to higher temperatures, at some temperature you find that your estimated density of states is departing from your estimates from lower temperatures. Okay, so that means that something is breaking down, and since there was only, you know, since we trust that we know how to do thermodynamic integration and we have enough samples of the local energy minima to build good histograms, the only thing that can go wrong is the assumption of harmonicity of the basins, okay? And so you can say, okay, so there is a temperature at which this is breaking down. Yeah. Sorry? It's the Cobb-Anderson mixture. Yeah? Okay. So so now I can also interrogate the harmonicity of the basins by comparing the excitation energy above the minima of my system in equilibrium with what I would expect if the system was harmonic, right? So what I expect if the system is harmonic is that I have a linear dependence on the temperature of the excitation energy, right? And so I plot things in a way that it's clear, but basically here I'm putting the inherent structure energies on the x-axis, and I'm but this is a stand-in for the temperature because there's a one-to-one mapping. And here is the difference of the instantaneous energies and the expectation based on the harmonic approximation, okay? And what you find is that again, it's fairly good at over some temperature range, but then it's breaking down. Okay, and we move on. As I already mentioned, we have the assumption of this. Based on the Gaussian density of states, I had this prediction of a 1/T temperature dependence of the inherent structure energies with temperature. And that's also something I can check. And what I find is that for each of these densities that I look at, there is some range over which this is valid, but there are departures. This is 1/T here, so this is high temperature. So there are departures as I go to sufficiently high temperatures. Okay, so so these are sort of different ways in which I identify the range over which the assumptions that I made are valid, and a range over which it's not valid. And so the interesting thing is, okay, this is, don't take that too seriously. This is noisy data because the temperatures sampled were discrete. But within those limitations, what you find is that all of these different temperatures match with each other, and they match with the onset temperature that I mentioned to you earlier. Okay, so basically, the upshot of all this is that there is a meaningful onset temperature as a function of density, in, at least in this system, below which all the assumptions that I've stated work fairly well. Okay, I think I'll skip over this. This is just sort of some other properties that change as you go across this onset temperature, but I don't have time for this. Okay, so this is sort of just a map of different things that we've talked about. We've talked about the onset temperature. We've talked about this Goldstein crossover or the mode coupling temperature identified with each other, the glass transition temperature, and this Kaussmann or the Fogel temperature. Okay, that's just to that's sort of the sequence in which they appear. Most of the computer simulations are done in this range, and I'll refer back to that later on in a bit. Okay, so I've already sort of said the things that I need to say about the calculation of fragility. What I show here are some comparisons of the fragility that one can calculate based on looking at the dynamics, the diffusivity in this case, and the thermodynamic fragility that I calculated. And along the way, we also look at how well the Adam-Gibbs relation is valid. Okay, and so this is log diffusivity versus 1 over T times SC, which should give you linear plots. And for all these different densities of the system, you do get these linear plots. But there are a couple of things which are a bit funny. Because, you know, if you look at this data, it's not really predictive. If, you know, it's because if with the Adam-Gibbs relation, if you knew the configuration entropy, you should be able to predict the diffusivity, right? And that's clearly not the case here because for a given combination of TSC, I have quite a variation of the diffusivity depending on the density that I have. So there is some additional density dependence which one should understand better. But yeah.
Because you have to specify the density. So why do you say there is it's not predictive, right? You only have to look only at one line.
Right, no. So if I tell you the configuration entropy and one normalization constant for the diffusivity, then it's predictive. But that sort of reference diffusivity changes with density, and there is no explanation for that at this level, right? Of course, the other issue which hasn't been looked at, I guess in this context carefully enough, is what difference it will make to look at the viscosity versus the diffusivity, because in principle it should make a difference. Right, but with those caveats, okay, all of this I can skip. This is just sort of, you know, data to show that this linear assumption of the vibrational frequency is actually good for this system, but it's also been found to be good for various other systems. As also, you know, okay, I won't say anything about the Gaussian density of states assumption, because if this is actually a vignette of what part of the density of states you're looking at, and it's a fairly small part in all the cases. So if it's not a straight line, it's a Gaussian. I mean, it's not to be, you know, but we do expect that you know, like I said, we do check for the 1 over t dependence, and it's valid over a substantial range. Okay. Right. So, okay. So that's a comparison of the thermodynamic and the kinetic fragilities that one calculates and within some limits and the caveats I mentioned, they seem to agree. But this is an analysis that can be, you know, so as far as the thermodynamics is concerned, what I showed you is what you can do. I mean, the assumptions about the nature of the density of states, et cetera, can change. but you expect that if Adam Gibbs works, there's a certain route to calculating the fragility of the systems. And here is one example now where the assumption about the density of states does not work, okay, which is the case of silica. And so as you've heard already, silica is the standard example for a strong glass former. And however, the work of various people, including Walter and Peter, and I guess those are the, Austin is not here, but he had some role in the work in mines, right? Showed is that if you look at a model of silica at high enough temperatures, you do find non-Arrhenius temperature dependence. Okay, so what you see is that you go from sort of a fragile behavior to strong behavior as you go to low temperatures. And on the other hand, if you look at the Adam Gibbs plot of the diffusivity versus 1 over TAC, you do find a convincing Adam Gibbs behavior. Okay, so what is happening? What is happening is that the Gauss assumption of a Gaussian density of states and correspondingly a 1 over t dependence of the energies of the local minima is not obeyed in this system. So what you see, this is plotted against temperature. As you come to low temperatures, there is sort of a hint of things flattening out. And this is now plotted against 1 over t, and that makes it more obvious that in the case of this lower density here, you're seeing departures from 1 over t behavior that are significant. And I don't have the data to show here, but if you ask what kind of a change in the density of states it corresponds to, what it corresponds to is something like a chopping off of the density of states. So the density of states effectively becomes narrower as you go to, so SC as a function of phi is parabolic if you have a Gaussian density of states, but if you have a change that is sharper as you go to low energies, then effectively the system has a narrower density of states when you're at low temperatures, and that corresponds, as I described to you earlier, stronger behavior. Okay, and this is Sorry? Yes? Well, it's dropping faster when you plot it against energy. But what you have to ask yourself is what happens as you vary the temperature. So what happens as you vary the temperature is that the system will basically get stuck in a very small range of energies, and that is that corresponds to strong behavior. Okay. Right. So, yeah.
Just to make a comment, I think it's easy to think about if this chopping off is because you're reaching an energy limit. The inherent structures are reaching a limit at which you can't produce inherent structures of lower energy. And if you see on the plot, the zero temperature black square in the main plot is the crystal energy.
Uh-huh.
And so you can get an energetic sense of why this inherent structure energy can't keep diving down with negative curvature. It's reaching a limit, and the states are piling up against that limit. And so the distribution is narrowing.
Good point. Okay. Right. So, okay. Let me now skip a whole lot of slides. Well, okay, so maybe I say a little bit what is here, okay? Basically, the same, in fact, the data that I showed and the analysis that I showed can be used to calculating a line of glass transition, ideal glass transitions in the system, and you can ask the question how that line of glass transitions is related to the other limit to the liquid state, which is a liquid gas spinodal. And what you find is that these two limits to the liquid state, beyond which a liquid cannot exist as a homogeneous, stably or metastably in equilibrium system, intersect at a finite temperature. And this has the consequence. This is the estimated glass transition line, and this is the estimated spinodal line, liquid gas spinodal. Yeah, it's the same system, the Cobb-Anderson mixture. Yeah, and so those two lines intersect at a finite temperature. So if you look below that temperature, you actually have a prediction of a mechanical stability limit to the glass, which I mentioned. Okay, so one of the things we also did, but you'll actually hear it from Mark, is to sort of do the calculation also through the approach that Mezard and Parisi developed. I guess you are going to describe that. And we find sort of not numerically consistent, but qualitatively consistent picture of what's happening. Okay, skip. Okay, so I think this is sort of the last bit that I'll talk about, which is the analysis of systems that are not in equilibrium. Using this picture, and I'll say a few words why it is appealing to think of it this way, because as I mentioned when I described to you the equation of state that was written in terms of the energy landscape parameters, I said there was a nice way to separate what was happening within individual basins and what was happening to the inherent structure component of the equation of state. And I had also said earlier, much earlier, that the reason for thinking about this energy landscape picture was this intuitive idea that local equilibration of the system was always fast, whereas equilibration that required hopping between local minima was the slow process. Okay, so when you're looking at aging systems with this perspective, you can say, you know, a good way to think about what happens when I take a system out of equilibrium is that first I will thermalize the system within a given basin, but there will be a much slower process through which the system will sample or approach the equilibrium sampling of the basins that are appropriate for the new temperature. Let's say if I do a temperature quench, there'll be a different distribution of basins that should be sampled, and the approach to that sampling will be a much slower process, right? So okay. Now, what we have already sort of discussed at some length is sort of, I mean, not at length, but I did make reference to it a few times, is that I can think of the energy of the inherent structures that I'm sampling when I'm in equilibrium as an alternative way of describing the state of the system. So for every temperature, I had a corresponding inherent structure energy. But if I'm not in equilibrium, then while the sampling of the individual basin that I might be sitting at any given instant is rapid and will thermalize, what will take longer is for me to reach the appropriate energies of the local minima, right? Now, this is now an additional new slow variable, and one can think of developing an approach to describe out of equilibrium behavior by saying that this is one additional parameter that I need to know. And if I knew that, I could say everything. I could fully characterize the system, even if it is out of equilibrium. Okay? And so this was something that these guys tried. And okay, so here is the nice cartoon of what I was trying to say. So imagine that each of these lines represents the free energy of this system if it was just sitting in one basin, right? And let's say that each of these lines corresponds to inherent structures at different energies, right? So if I were to take a system that's sitting here and do a rapid quench, what happens is it'll rapidly go along this line where it's thermalizing now to the new temperature very quickly, but then it'll make a much slower transition across these different minima, okay? So because the real process is separated in this manner, what we want to do is to see if we can also separate our description in the same fashion and if it makes sense, okay? And so, again, this is rewriting the free energy of the system in terms of the configurational entropy plus the basin free energy. So this now subsumes the energy at the minimum that I had before explicitly. And if I wanted to find the most probable energy, what I would normally do is to take the derivative of this, which I do now also, and set it to zero. But instead of saying that this is a condition for me to determine the inherent structure energy at a given temperature in equilibrium, I'm going to now say that, in addition, I'm also going to specify what this energy is. Okay? So then the question is, what do I gain by it? Okay? So one by one, so I specify what my inherent structure energy is, and I also specify that the equilibrium or the temperature of the bath. And I say that this is the temperature that has to go into the vibrational part of the free energy, because the vibrational thermalization is always rapid. So whatever the bath temperature will be the temperature that goes into the vibrational free energy. But I now say that this the temperature that's sitting in front of the configurational part, I'm going to say, is not determined by the bath, but by the inherent structure energy that I'm sampling for a given system at a given time, right? And so if I do that, then this equation becomes a condition for the value of that temperature. Okay, so I have rewriting this, an expression for the, sorry, notations keep changing. But Yeah, I have an expression for what they call the internal temperature, where F is the final temperature. So keeping in mind a quench from an initial to a final temperature. And so you have this stuff here, which is, so F basin was the energy of the inherent structure plus the vibrational free energy. So that's the one plus this guy. And this quantity went to the denominator. So the long and short of it is you have now an expression for the internal temperature as a function of the energy of the minima that you sample when your system is aging. Okay. So what do you do with this? What these guys did was to, yeah? If I assume what? No. So this is indeed the term that arises that is finite if you don't make that assumption. Okay. So this is what Austin was asking about 2 days ago, and I said I'll talk about it. Yes.
And you decrease the temperature, the states go closer in free energy. You have a contraction of the space, and this is the origin of that term. I mean, at least this is the way I explained it to Schrodinger.
No, but contraction.
You have no contraction. Energy levels.
Correct. That is fine. Okay, that is here.
Occupy a certain range. Suppose the total number of energy level is the same. And then if they approach each other, you have a contraction.
Correct.
Of a space. And this is the origin of that term. Not
right,
the fact that the size of the basins is not the same. The size of the relevant basin, by assumption, if you use that, is the same. This is what we discussed with Miguel Virasoro in a paper that preceded
yes.
that one.
Well, this is the inherent structure talk. I was going to mention that. But this here is the derivative of the vibrational free energy with respect to the energy of the minima. Right? So, if I had no dependence of the vibrational free energy on the energy of the minima, that term will be zero. No? Like God, he's saying neither yes nor no. So okay, So anyway, you are going to talk about this. Okay, so we can. Right. So I guess I won't go through the details of this, but. What this was used to is to calculate the violation, or is to look at this so-called FDT ratio, which is, so if you have the FDT relation between, where the temperature here in equilibrium is the bath temperature, but if the fluctuation dissipation theorem is violated, then this temperature is, oops. Okay. Oh, escape there. Okay, thanks. okay, so this temperature is not the bath temperature if the system is not in equilibrium necessarily. And what is shown here is the plotting of the correlation. Sorry, this is the correlation function, and that's the response. And the lines that are drawn through are the slopes that correspond to the internal temperature that's calculated through the procedure that I described. And what you see is that, in fact, you are able to, in this case, capture that internal temperature through this means. Yeah. Okay, maybe this is something that, okay. I think, okay, so other stuff I'll skip except to say here that, somebody mentioned the coax effect, right? Which was sort of described as an illustration that, even if you try to invoke additional internal parameters or an additional internal parameter, it is not sufficient to describe the state of an aging system, and that's indeed also the conclusion in this case. Won't go to the details. I think I'll skip that. Okay, so... okay, so this is sort of a summary of what I've described. The analysis of dynamics in liquids through the energy landscape approach provides a useful way of understanding some processes leading to relaxation. But, you know, not only what I presented, but in general, I would say that we don't really have a satisfactory dynamical description that is based on this approach. And this is a serious limitation. There have been attempts, and in fact, you can certainly do some calculations with an in principle correct dynamical description, but whether it's sort of satisfactory in terms of giving you a handle on how to think about the system is a different story. I mentioned a lot the Adam Gibbs relation, and that sort of comes up as a central concept in trying to relate an energy landscape description to dynamics, and we don't really have, certainly from this approach, a satisfactory understanding of why this relation is valid, and that's one of the major goals, I would say, in pursuing this or any other line of inquiry that sort of attempts to understand the dynamics of the system through some form of a landscape picture. And okay, so the other point, which was the content of this slide here, but I won't sort of, is the observation that according to some ideas about what is happening in structural glasses, there is sort of these two regimes above and below the mode coupling temperature. And you know, expectations, including Goldstein's original proposal, are that a landscape picture and activated dynamics, et cetera, are valid at temperatures below this crossover temperature. But what we find through this, through the work that I presented here and other works, is that there is an applicability of a landscape a picture at temperatures much higher than what we might have expected. And this is also a regime where, by other measures, mode coupling theory also works very well. And this combination of facts is a bit of a puzzle. And Sarika, who's not here anymore, oh, there she is, will sort of talk about some attempts to sort of rationalize this. But I think that's an important problem to be taken up further. OK, I'll stop. Thank you for your attention.
The configuration entropy should count the number of possible configurations in which one can make a glass. Now, the identification of of inherent structures as states in which a glass can found is certainly very interesting. It leads to a beautiful result. However, it leads to some conceptual problem, because you could have very small rearrangement of configurations that change you from inherent structure to an inherent structure to another, but leaves you in the same glassy configuration. And there is an argument which is due by to Stillinger, that actually tells you that this kind of narrowing of the configuration entropy, which was depicted on the blackboard, inevitably occurs if you identify the configurational entropy with the inherent structure multiplicity. Right. In particular, you cannot have. The possibility of an ideal glass transition is related to the fact that at the ground state the slope of the configuration entropy is finite, and you find that if you identify with inner structure, this is always infinite, mm-hmm. and so you couldn't. So, I think that one should take care. This problem.
No, so the two comments about that. One is, in fact, I didn't even. Skip the slide, but I had a slide there about metabasins, which I didn't even mention. But there wasn't much on that slide. I was going to apologize for not covering that topic. So there has been an attempt to sort of go beyond looking at inherent structures as defined by local energy minima to collect groups of inherent structures somehow, which are called metabasins, which will in principle rectify this problem. I think it's an interesting thing to do. It's a very messy and difficult thing to do properly. David will say something about it in the afternoon. So in fact, what he's going to describe sounds. One of the problems that I've sort of had with this metabasin work is that. You're trying to, at some level, you have this hierarchy of, like Walter said, if you have the Hamiltonian, you should be able to calculate structure, perhaps. Well, he didn't put it that way, but you sort of, for looking at dynamics, you want to be able to build that on the basis of structural and equilibrium properties that you assume to be known. But in the metabasin analysis of Andreas Heuer, it's not a criticism, but what they've had to do is to look at the dynamics itself in order to determine what a metabasin is. And that's sort of that's a first step, but you have to go further. And what David is going to talk about will indicate one direction in which one could go. Yeah.
Apply at that point.
Right. No, but I think...
Okay. Sorry. Well,
let me say it, and I'll elaborate. He said that the Stillinger argument will hold at the very bottom of the landscape, right? But So yeah, that was David's comment. I think you know, if in a strict sense, even though it sort of looks like a rigorous argument of some sort, if you think about, I mean, I've sort of worried my head about that as well. But if you think about a crystal, right, where you don't have much of a problem thinking of a crystal with defects as defining a very well-defined state. So if you knew everything you wanted to know, you wouldn't have a problem with inherent structures either. We just don't know how to sort of... we call a state, but yeah. So, but on the other hand, I think yeah, looking at inherent structures is okay. I mean, I'm not worried about the extra states that you generate by making defects. I'm more worried about what you don't know about the phase space connectivity and how that affects your picture of what's going on if you go through this approach. Okay, I think that's a good place to stop.